Today's lecture is about the solar neutrino puzzle. What I actually want to do is to tell you a very remarkable detective story, as exciting as any detective story that you would have read. Now let us go back to the discovery by Becquerel of the phenomena of radioactivity. As you know, soon after that, with Rutherford, it became clear that heavy nuclei are unstable and they emit alpha particles, beta particles, and gamma particles, which was later identified not as particle but as photons, gamma rays. Now, there was, what is alpha, what is beta decay? Beta decay is explained in that first equation over there. An atom of atomic, a nucleus of atomic mass A and atomic charge Z decays, emits an electron, and what it leaves behind is another nucleus whose atomic weight remains unchanged, it is still A, but its atomic charge has increased by one unit. That is called beta decay. Now, soon after that, a phenomenon was discovered which was called the inverse beta decay. This was explained by one of Fermi's students, Giancarlo Wick, in which the atomic charge decreases by one unit, and what is emitted is a positively charged electron, which we call today as positron. Now, there was a deep puzzle about this beta decay, and the puzzle was the following. In alpha decay, which Rutherford studied, a nucleus decays from one energy level A to another energy level B and emits an alpha particle, which is just the helium-4 nucleus. So the energy of this alpha particle was precisely equal to the difference in energy between the two states of the nucleus. So that was understood in terms of the nucleus making a transition, like an atom makes a transition from one energy level to another, emitting the alpha particle. But there was a problem with the electrons. And that problem was that the energy of the electron was not unique. So what is plotted in this figure on the y-axis is the number of electrons with energy E as a function of the energy of the electron E. You see that it is a continuous spectrum, although it has a very sharp cutoff at a E max, maximum energy. Now, this would violate energy conservation. So how can an electron come out with all possible energy if the nucleus is making a transition between two discrete levels and emits an electron? Then the energy of the electron must be precisely equal to the energy level difference between the initial and final state of the nucleus. But the energy is continuous. So this was a very big puzzle in physics. It was so much of a puzzle that Niels Bohr even suggested that in quantum physics, energy conservation itself may be violated. Now, there's a very radical thing to say, but Niels Bohr actually suggested this might actually happen. But young Pauli was not convinced of this. Now, Pauli tried to solve this problem, and in 1930, he sent a postcard to a friend of his, who was not even a physicist. And in that postcard, he suggested, look, there's no need to abandon the conservation of energy, which has been a sacred principle in physics. Maybe a third particle is emitted in beta decay that you are not detecting, which will take care of energy and momentum conservation. But he knew that this particular hypothetical third particle must have certain well-defined properties. It must be electrically neutral. Second, it must have a very, very nearly zero mass, because this maximum energy of the beta spectrum is not very large. And thirdly, it must have spin 1/2, because the proton has spin 1/2, and therefore any new particle that you emit in that equation must also have spin 1/2. And he called this particle the neutron. The year was 1930. 2 years later, a young student of Rutherford, Chadwick, discovered a neutral particle, which was a very heavy particle, 2,000 times more massive than the electron. And then he called that the neutron. But that was not the particle that Pauli had in mind, because the particle Pauli had in mind must have very nearly zero mass. Therefore, the following year, Enrico Fermi took all this very seriously, and he christened Pauli's particle as neutrino, the Italian word for baby neutron, tiny neutron, okay, the neutrino. And this neutrino was therefore predicted between 1930 and 33, and it took a very long time to find it. It took 26 years to find this elusive particle. And that's why there is this detective story that I'm going to tell you about. Now, let us look at the physics of this. One of the most spectacular theoretical achievements of the 20th century was the construction in 1934 by Enrico Fermi of the theory of beta decay. This turned out to be the forerunner for all modern theories, including quantum electrodynamics and strong interactions, and gauge theories that are prevalent today. Now, according to Fermi, in beta decay, this is what happens. A neutron inside the atomic nucleus spontaneously decays to a proton and emits an electron and one of Pauli's particles, a neutrino. Now, Fermi asserted that the electron didn't exist inside the nucleus. He said the electron is spontaneously created. Okay? So, as you know, that's what happens in quantum electrodynamics. When an atom emits a photon, when the electron jumps from one energy level to another, then the photon is not residing inside the nucleus. The photon is spontaneously created. But quantum electrodynamics came much later. Okay? So the very first physical theory of a spontaneous creation of a new particle was Fermi's theory of beta decay. Now, of course, he sent this paper to Nature, and in its own pompous fashion, Nature rejected this paper by saying, this paper is very remotely connected with reality. And of course, then Fermi sent it to a German paper, which published it. And then soon, this theory became the rage of physics. And then 5 years later, Nature reproduced Fermi's paper, although it had been published 5 years earlier in some other journal. So, to my mind, Fermi's theory of beta decay was one of the greatest intellectual achievements of the 20th century, because the way things unfolded, other theories were based on this model. Then his student, Giancarlo Wick, in Rome, explained why the inverse beta decay occurs. He said, by that time they knew the mass of the proton is less than the mass of the neutron, therefore this decay cannot spontaneously happen. But inside the nucleus, it can happen because the other nuclei supply the required energy and momentum. So Giancarlo Wick suggested that what happens in inverse beta decay is that a proton inside the nucleus decays to a neutron and emits a positron and a neutrino. Today, we know that there is a neutrino and its antiparticle, which we call as the antineutrino. But in 1933-34, one didn't know that. So when Fermi wrote this theory, he did not say it has to be an antineutrino. That came only in the late 50s and early 60s. So today, that's what you would say. in beta decay, what is emitted is an anti-neutrino. And the reason is that in the left-hand side of the equation, there are no light particles. In the right-hand side, electron is a light particle. Therefore, there must be a light antiparticle on the right-hand side. Therefore, that quantum number is conserved. Similarly, this is an antiparticle. Therefore, the neutrino has to be a particle to conserve what we today call as conservation of lepton number, conservation of light particles, lepton for light particles. Now, first, there was a neutrino associated with the electron. That we will call now carefully the electron neutrino. And we know the electron neutrino has an antiparticle. Now, besides the electron, there are two other light particles or lepton, the mu meson, which was predicted by Homi Bhabha, and then later on found in cosmic rays, and the tau meson, also found in cosmic rays. Now, it turns out that there are neutrinos and antineutrinos associated with these two new leptons also. Therefore, the family of neutrinos really consists of six particles. The electron neutrino and its antiparticle, the muon neutrino and its antiparticle, and the tau neutrino and its antiparticle. So there are six neutrinos that we know today that have been experimentally measured. The important thing to appreciate is that the Sun produces only the electron neutrino. Because what happened in the Sun, as you remember, as we will revise again, in the first of the proton-proton chain reaction, a proton combines with another proton to form a deuteron, which is a proton and a neutron. Therefore, a proton has decayed to a neutron plus a positron plus a neutrino. So our story is only about the electron neutrino, not about electron antineutrino, let alone the other four types of neutrinos. So please remember this. The Sun produces only electron neutrinos if Hans Bethe's theory is correct. All right. Now, in the 1930s, Hans Bethe and Rudolf Peierls worked out the cross-section of this neutrino particle, neutrino. Please remember, this neutrino was a very elusive particle, predicted in 1930 by Pauli, found only in 1956. So obviously, it interacts very little with matter, otherwise you would have found it in 2 days. So they worked out the cross-section for interaction of neutrino with matter, and that cross-section is E over mc squared, where E is the energy of the neutrino, and mc squared is the rest mass energy of the electron, whole squared, multiplied by an awfully small number, 10 to the power 44 centimeters squared. So the cross-section for interaction of neutrino with matter is incredibly small. Now, if that cross-section were written in terms of the mean free path, concept that we are more familiar with, then the mean free path of neutrino is 2 times 10 to the power 20 centimeters divided by rho, where rho is the mass density of the material with which the neutrino is interacting in centimeters. So if you put a density of 2 or 3 or 4 or 5, the mean free path comes to 10 to the power 20 centimeters. 10 to the power 18 centimeters is the distance light will travel in 1 year. Therefore, the mean free path of the neutrino is about 100 light years in lead. Okay, so if you constructed a cylinder of lead which is 100 light years long, then there is a probability that this neutrino will interact with one of those nuclei. Okay? So, I hope you appreciate that any attempt to detect these neutrinos is a very, very brave attempt, if not mere stupidity. But our story is about this detection of neutrinos. And why do you go after such a crazy problem? for a very simple reason. Let us go back to Eddington 1920, the conjecture that the sun radiates because it's converting hydrogen to helium, enhanced by the successful theory of 1938. Please remember, Hans Bethe was your age at that time when he constructed this complete theory of the energy production in the stars, the sun and the stars. As I said in the last lecture, the energy is produced by proton-proton chain reaction, which we will revisit now. And that theory was worked out by Hans Bethe in detail in 1938 in a paper published in Physical Review. But as I alluded to last time, Carl von Weizsäcker had suggested another mechanism, which is the carbon-nitrogen-oxygen cycle, autocatalytic reaction. And Hans Bethe worked out the complete theory of that also in the following year. As I said last time, this CNO reaction is more important for stars which are slightly more massive than the sun, 2, 3, 4 solar masses. So we are now going to talk about the sun, therefore it's only the proton-proton chain reaction that is important for us. So let us recall what we learned in the last lecture. The first step in the proton-proton chain reaction is the formation of the deuteron. So what we said was two protons collide, and when they are near each other, one of the protons transforms itself into a neutron, emitting a positron and an electron neutrino. So in that reaction, a neutrino is produced. So I will write this down, because this story that I'm going to tell you is all about the detection of the neutrino. So proton plus proton producing a deuteron plus a positron plus a neutrino, an electron neutrino. Now, as I said, this is a very unlikely process. It takes place only once in about 10 billion years. But then, because there are 10 to the 57 protons in the nucleus, this does happen. And once this happens, the next reaction proceeds very quickly. A deuteron interacts with a proton to form helium-3 nucleus and emits a gamma ray. There is no neutrino there. So now, the reason why I did not discuss any other channel for producing helium-4 yesterday is that in 85% of the cases, what happens is that two helium-3 nuclei combine to produce a helium-4 nucleus, and you get back your two protons. So in 85% of the cases, the neutrino is produced in this reaction. But it is the other 15% that concerns us today. In the second branch, which is 15%, the following thing happens. A helium-3 nucleus combines with a helium-4 nucleus to produce a beryllium-7 nucleus. And that beryllium-7 nucleus combines with an electron to produce a lithium-7 nucleus and a neutrino. And the lithium-7 nucleus combines with a proton to produce two helium-4 nuclei. So there is the second channel for producing neutrinos, and that is beryllium-7 combining with an electron to produce lithium-7 plus a neutrino. And this happens in 15% of the time, not quite 15%, but slightly less than 15%, because if you're really careful, as Hans Bethe was, there is one other way, and that happens only in 0.01% of the time. And what happens in that very small channel is that the helium-3 nucleus combines with helium-4 nucleus and produces beryllium-7, like in the reaction above. But that beryllium-7 produces boron-8. And then the boron-8 decays to beryllium-8, releasing a neutrino. So let's write that also down. That is boron-8 decays to beryllium-8, plus positron, plus electron neutrino, and this happens in about 0.01%. The reason why I lauded Hans Bethe last time is that when he worked out this reaction in his 1938 paper, he just didn't bother just about the 85%, but the remaining 15% and the remaining 0.01%, right? Having done that, there was not a single word Hans Bethe spoke about neutrinos. And Hans Bethe didn't speak anything about neutrinos for the remaining 50 years. And he came back to neutrinos with a vengeance when he was almost 90 years old in the context of supernova explosions of stars. It's an absolutely extraordinary thing that Hans Bethe... So neutrinos are produced in three reactions that are written for your future reference in the blackboard. Please notice in particular the neutrino that is produced by the beryllium-7 decay and the boron-8 decay. Sometimes nature is very unkind. It allows you to detect only these neutrinos. It does not allow you to detect the overwhelming majority of neutrinos. So the experiment that I'm going to describe to you was designed to detect this beryllium and boron nuclei, beryllium and boron neutrinos, and not the bulk of the neutrinos. So how do we know all this is true? If protons are being fused into helium, the only witnesses to that are the gamma rays, the positrons, and the neutrinos. So for every one helium nucleus that is produced, two electron neutrinos are emitted, and two positrons are emitted. Now, if Hans Bethe's theory is correct, if Eddington is correct, then the sun must be radiating 10 to the power 38 neutrinos, electron neutrinos per second, and 10 to the power 15 of them must be going through you every second. Right? So keep that in mind, 10 to the power 38 neutrinos, and that is spreading over a surface area of a sphere, which is 4 pi r squared. So you know exactly how many neutrinos should be passing through 1 square centimeter of the detector here on Earth. And you better find it. Because only if you find that, and if that number matches with this number, you can believe in Eddington and Hans Bethe's theory. Now, the gamma rays, as I said last time, don't escape as gamma rays. They get degraded due to absorption and re-emission, and they emerge thousands and millions of years later as visible photons that the stars radiate. The positrons, of course, will instantly annihilate against electrons, producing more gamma rays. So the neutrinos are the only things they escape because their mean free path is 100 light years. But they are hostile witnesses. Like very often we have cases in India where somebody runs over people who are sleeping in the footpath with a BMW or a Mercedes-Benz, and then there are 9 witnesses. By the time the case comes to the court, the witnesses change their story, right? They are hostile witnesses. So the neutrinos as you will see, are very hostile witnesses. Now our story begins. Our story begins with a young theoretical physicist by name John Bacall, who was working in Princeton at the Institute of Advanced Study. Now, he was convinced that one must go after these neutrinos and find them. So what he did was to persuade a distinguished experimental chemist by name Raman Davis, who is there on the left in this picture, to undertake this mad experiment of trying to detect the electron neutrinos from the sun. And Raman Davis said, fine, I know how to do it. So the first thing Raman Davis did was to find himself a gold mine, an abandoned gold mine in America, 1 kilometer underground, because what you don't want are cosmic ray particles interacting with matter and producing neutrinos, so you want to be able to detect the solar neutrinos. So to shield it against cosmic rays, you go as far down under the Earth as possible, and what you normally do these days was first done by Raman Davis, is to go and find an abandoned mine, because it's too expensive otherwise to dig 1 kilometer and set up a laboratory there. And what he did was to go and buy 100,000 gallons of carbon tetrachloride. So when you give your suit or a sari to a dry cleaner, which is tumbling in the washing machine, what is inside the washing machine is carbon tetrachloride. I remember as a college student using carbon tetrachloride to do Raman scattering experiment. It's a very strong Raman active molecule. So you go to the supermarket and buy 100,000 gallons of carbon tetrachloride. And why? Because Raman Davis said, when a neutrino interacts with chlorine 37 nucleus, it'll produce an argon 37 nucleus. And of course, it'll emit an electron. We are not bothered by the electron. And so the name of the game is to detect this argon 37 nucleus. If you detect one argon 37 nucleus, then it means that one neutrino from the sun has been detected in your detector. Okay? So what he did was to count the number of radioactive argon nucleus. So how do you detect the argon nucleus? Because the argon 37 nucleus is an unstable nucleus, and therefore it decays to something else, so you detect the daughter products of that. So here it is, friends. Believe it or not, every few months, not every few days, Davis used to collect about 15 argon atoms inside a tank which had 10 to the power 30 atoms of chlorine. So the name of the game is to detect 10, 15, 20 argon atoms in a month. So that tells you how brave you have to be to go after an experiment like this. Okay. Now, what kind of neutrinos was Raman Davis trying to detect? So look at this picture very carefully. What is plotted on the y-axis is the flux of neutrinos, the number of neutrinos, and what is plotted on the x-axis is the energy of the neutrino going from 0.1 million electron volt, 1 million electron volt, 10 million electron volt, and so on. You notice that the overwhelming majority of neutrinos are produced by the proton-proton chain reaction, which is on the left. Please notice the logarithmic scale, that is 10 to the power 11 in some units. So you notice that the boron 8 nucleus, which is that bump over there, is only producing 10 to the power 5 in those flux units. So it is 6 orders of magnitude smaller. So let us recall what we said. In the proton-proton chain reaction, neutrinos are produced in the following way. Proton combines with proton, forms a deuteron, emits this. whose energy is 0.4 MeV. Then there is beryllium 7 neutrino and boron 8 neutrinos. They have energy of about 0.8 MeV, 0.4 MeV, and 15 MeV. So you notice that the beryllium 7 neutrino, which is the spike over here and a spike over here, it is a monochromatic in its energy. There is very little flux there. And the boron 8 nucleus, which is that big bump, is high energy neutrinos, 15 million electron volts. And what I have indicated there is that the chlorine detector of Raymond Davis can only detect neutrinos with energy greater than about 1 million electron volt. So chlorine, which was used in the first detector, can only detect neutrinos of high energy. And the only neutrinos of high energy that you have are the boron 8 neutrinos, which are only 0.01% of all the neutrinos the sun produces. All right, fine. So keep that in mind. So the Raymond Davis experiment is detecting a very small percentage of neutrinos, even in principle, and those are the high energy neutrinos. Now, what are the results? I remember as a young graduate student in Chicago, in the year 1968, Raymond Davis coming and giving a colloquium. I remember that day very well. And the results of the experiment are expressed in units which are called SNU. SNU stands for solar neutrino units. Not surprisingly, one SNU is 10 to the power minus 36 neutrinos per second. An awfully small number. One SNU is 10 to the power minus 36 neutrinos per second. Please be reminded that in a chlorine detector, the threshold for neutrino absorption is 0.8 MeV. That means you can only detect neutrinos with higher energy. Neutrinos from the PP chain reaction, which is 85% of the neutrinos, cannot be detected even in principle in the Raymond Davis experiment. Experiment can detect only neutrinos produced by the beryllium 7 decay and the decay of boron 8. What is the predicted rate according to theoretical physics? The predicted rate is 7.9. The error is 1 plus or minus 0.33 solar neutrino units. And what did he find? He found 2.1 plus or minus 0.9 solar neutrino units. So Raymond Davis concluded, and I very vividly remember this 50 years ago today, that he said, look, I only detected 1/3 argon atoms as were predicted. Now all of us thought this guy was completely crazy, because he's doing a near impossible experiment. Instead of celebrating and opening a bottle of champagne saying, I have detected solar neutrinos, the guy grumbles and says, look, I only detected 1/3 of them. Nobody in his right mind would believe that, would they? I mean, look, it is such a horrendously difficult experiment. But Raymond Davis was a very good chemist, a very good experimentalist. He insisted that I know what I'm doing, and I'll tell you, only 1/3 of the neutrinos interacted with my detector. So what was wrong? Well, let us see everything that possibly could be wrong. First, perhaps our theoretical calculations are wrong. After all, when Hans Bethe calculates these rates, he assumes a certain value for the density and temperature at the very center of the sun. Why? The density will tell you how many particles there are that are likely to collide. And the temperature will tell you what is the mean energy with which they will collide. And as I said last time, nuclear reactions are very strong functions of temperature. For example, in this case, it is function of T to the power 40. T is the temperature of the gas at the center of the sun. So even a small error in the temperature and density at the center of the sun could lead to a very large error in your prediction for how many neutrinos the sun should produce every second. So don't jump up and down and say, look, I haven't detected everything. So that could be wrong. Secondly, perhaps the experiment was wrong. You don't know. And thirdly, something is wrong with fundamental physics. By the way, even in the first thing, there are two things. I only said one thing, and that is so far. That is, your theoretical prediction could be wrong. There is a second theoretical prediction, namely, what is the rate at which those neutrinos will interact with my detector? You could have been wrong in that also, the cross-section for interaction in your detector. And the third is, something is fundamentally wrong with nuclear physics. All right? Fine. But there was one person and his collaborator working in Moscow at the time who thought differently. So let's listen to what he had to say. Now please remember the neutrino family. First, there was the electron neutrino and its antiparticle that Fermi and Wick talked about in 1934. Then there were the other leptons, mu mesons and tau mesons. And then you have the family of neutrinos, which consists of electron neutrino, muon neutrino, tau neutrino, and their antiparticles. There are six neutrinos in the family. Please remember, the sun only emits electron neutrinos. It does not emit even electron antineutrinos, only electron neutrinos. Bruno Pontecorvo, an Italian physicist who was a collaborator of Enrico Fermi in Rome in the early days, and when the Second World War broke out, he emigrated to Russia. So he was in Russia at that time, and he suggested, look, maybe Raymond Davis is right. Maybe the neutrinos have suffered some personality disorder. Maybe something happened to them on the way to the Earth. Recall, only electron neutrinos are produced in the fusion reaction in the sun, which is written on the board there. Pontecorvo and his Russian colleague Gribov suggested that the electron neutrinos, as they left the sun and traveled to the Earth, periodically changed from electron neutrino to tau neutrino to mu neutrino to tau neutrino to electron neutrino in a periodic fashion. So by the time they reached the Earth, one third of them were tau neutrinos, one third of them were mu neutrinos, and only one third of them were electron neutrinos, although when they left, 100% of them were electron neutrinos. So he said, this is what is happening. This is why Raymond Davis has found a deficit of 66%. The deficit was not something arbitrary. It was one third is what he had detected, okay? Now you may question that one third, but that's what Raymond Davis had claimed. That is, their flavor is oscillating. Neutrinos are flavors. They either come as electron flavor or muon flavor or tau flavor, like ice creams, and they oscillated between these three. So when they arrived at the Earth, they are a mixture of three different types of neutrinos. Please remember that Davis's experiment could detect, in principle, only the electron flavor. Therefore, Pontecorvo and Gribov suggested that it is not surprising that he detected only one third of them. And of course, nobody took this seriously. The real suspects were, one, the theoretical prediction of the number of neutrinos produced in the sun is wrong. The second, the theoretical calculation of the rate of detection in the chlorine detector is wrong. And third is experimental errors. It's such a difficult experiment. So John Bacall was a very energetic and persuasive young man, persuaded about 100 extremely brilliant theoretical physicists all over the world, from Japan to America, Europe, everywhere, including in India, to go back and recalculate the solar model, the standard model of the sun, and calculate the number of neutrinos that you would expect. And Raymond Davis said, fine, I will go and redo my experiment and let us see what happens. Now, after 20 years of extremely hard work by exceedingly clever theoretical physicists, they couldn't find anything wrong in the theoretical predictions. Similarly, Raymond Davis couldn't find anything wrong. The first result, if you remember, that I told you about was 1968. He continued with that experiment till 1988 here. And you see the data. The red line is the theoretically expected flux on Earth. And the mean value of 20 years of data gave 0.5 in this unit, whereas it should have been 1.5 in this unit. Therefore, after 20 years of hard experimentation, Davis was even more convinced that only one-third of the neutrinos are there, electron neutrinos. So, now you've got to take it seriously. So you say, all right, look, Raymond Davis was a very brave guy. He went after this 0.01% of the neutrinos because that is all the chlorine could detect. Let's go and look at these 85% of the neutrinos because there are lots of them. Maybe this deficit will disappear. Okay? All right. But please remember that the proton-proton chain reaction neutrinos produce neutrinos of low energy. So you need a detector which will detect low energy neutrinos. So what people decided was to have a detector which was gallium. So the gallium detector would detect neutrinos in the energy range about 0.2 MeV to about 1 MeV, which catches the peak of the proton-proton reaction neutrinos. And how does gallium detect this? Gallium-71 interacts with electron neutrino to produce germanium-71. And the threshold for this reaction is 0.23 million electron volt. Now, germanium-71 is a radioactive nucleus. It decays back in about several days. So the name of the game is to detect the decay of germanium-71, like argon-37 that Raymond Davis detected. Now, these experiments were very critical because theoreticians believed that they could calculate more accurately the expected flux of these proton-proton neutrinos. Now, the radioactive germanium decays by capturing an electron, the inverse of the reaction given above, with a lifetime about 11.43 days. Now, gallium is not something you can easily go to a supermarket and buy. It's a very difficult material to get hold of. Two experiments were planned. One was an experiment which was called Galax. This used 30 tons of gallium in an aqueous solution, and it was located in the Gran Sasso tunnel in the Swiss Alps between Italy on the south and Switzerland in the north, a deep tunnel, many kilometers of mountains on side. And the other experiment was called the SAGE experiment, which was a collaborative experiment between Soviets and Americans. SAGE stands for that. And they used 60 tons of gallium, and they used it in the mountains in the Baskin Valley, in the Caucasus Mountains. So 90 tons of gallium was all the gallium that existed in the whole of the Earth. They gathered every ounce of gallium for these two experiments. It was a terribly important experiment, you appreciate. Now, the surprising result of these much-awaited experiments, two experiments, was that the substantial number of the low-energy neutrinos were also missing. So this deepened the mystery. So you couldn't simply say high-energy neutrinos, we didn't do the calculation right, but the low-energy neutrinos were also missing. So then, Japanese, who tend to be very brave in these experiments, said, look, we will do a different kind of experiment. We will use water as the detector, because I can then have lots of water. There's no problem in getting water, right? And how do you detect neutrinos with water? So please remember this, because we'll be coming back to this again and again and again. A neutrino interacts with an electron in water, scatters off the electron, goes off in certain other direction, and the electron, like in Compton scattering, acquires a velocity which is relativistic, and a relativistically moving electron with a velocity greater than the phase velocity of light in the medium will emit Cherenkov light, as we discussed in the lecture on plasma. And this Cherenkov light will be directed in a narrow cone in the forward direction. So the name of the game in this detector is to detect the Cherenkov light from the electrons. Okay? Now, please remember, this scattering will happen for any flavor of the neutrino. So the incident neutrino could be an electron neutrino, a muon neutrino, or a tau neutrino. Although the probability of detecting electron neutrino is much higher, about 6.5 times higher than the probability of detecting muon neutrino and tau neutrino. Right? So theoretical calculation suggested that most of the time you'll only be detecting electron neutrino. Although in principle, with a lower efficiency, you will also be detecting muon neutrinos and tau neutrinos, which of course don't come from the sun. But just for completeness, this is being stated at the moment. So, what are the characteristics of this experiment? First, an important feature, which I already mentioned in an earlier lecture, is that in this, you can reconstruct the direction from which the incident neutrino came, because the electron is scattered more or less in the forward direction, and it certainly emits in the forward direction. Therefore, if I extrapolate that Cherenkov photon backwards, I can tell from which direction the incident neutrino came. So this experiment has excellent directionality. Second, this also provides an excellent arrival time of the neutrinos. It tells you exactly when your photomultipliers lit up. And that is how the neutrinos from the supernova of 1987 were detected. The experiment that I'm going to describe now, which was set up by the Japanese to detect the solar neutrinos, suddenly detected a burst of neutrinos on the 23rd of February, 1987. And when you pointed this Cherenkov cone backwards, it pointed to the large Magellanic cloud, which is where the supernova occurred. So the first detection of neutrinos from a supernova was done with this Kamiokande detector, which I'm going to describe, which was set up by the Japanese to detect the solar neutrinos. And of course, the person involved collected a Nobel Prize for this discovery. The experiment was set up in a place called Kamiokande, and the experiment is located 1 kilometer underground. It is a cylindrical tank whose diameter is 16 meters and whose length is 16 meters. it is filled about 3,000 metric tons of ordinary tap water. Now, surrounding that cylinder are 20-inch photomultiplier tubes, about 1,000 of them, to detect the Cherenkov of light. Now, this experiment, like Davis's experiment, is sensitive mainly to the high energy neutrinos produced by the boron 8 decay, which is a very small percentage, 0.01%. The first results were announced in 1989 from the Kamiokande experiment. And then what they found was that the number of high energy neutrinos detected with this water detector, not chlorine detector, was again less than predicted by the standard model of the sun. But the discrepancy was slightly less severe than in the chlorine detector. The chlorine detector detected only 1/3. The discrepancy was 66%. But here, it was slightly less. So that was very intriguing. And what the Japanese typically do when they face with situation like this, they say, okay, we'll build a bigger detector and resolve this. So they built the Kamiokande super detector, the super Kamiokande detector. Now this was a really impressive detector. It is deep underground in a mountain. And what you have is this enormous cylinder surrounded by another cylinder. The whole thing is filled with water. The outer volume between the outer cylinder and the inner cylinder is filled with 32,000 tons of water, not 3,000, 32,000 tons of water. The inner volume contained 18,000 tons of water. And the walls of the inner cylinder were covered with not 1,000 photomultiplier tubes, but 11,000 ultra-high sensitive photomultiplier tubes to detect the Cherenkov light. Right? So friends, here it is. As it was being filled with water, there are the three men in a boat. I don't know how many of you read this famous book. And these are the photomultiplier tubes. They are as being reflected in the water. And these are really high precision photomultiplier tubes. They're inspecting these tubes before the experiment. Well, here are the results of the super Kamiokande detector. Like in the Kamiokande 2 experiment, there was a deficit, and the deficit was less than in the chlorine experiment, but this time they could quantify the deficit. They found that they had actually detected 45% of the predicted value. 45%, not 33%, 45%. So, let's look at it. One picture is worth 10,000 words. That's the number of electron neutrinos you expect to detect. Raman Davis, who could detect only electron neutrinos, detected 1/3. Super Kamiokande detected 45%. But please remember that Super Kamiokande could detect all neutrino flavors, the electron, the muon, the tau neutrino, although with lesser efficiency than electron neutrino. This was very intriguing. Am I detecting 45% because Davis got it wrong? Or am I detecting 45% because in addition to the 33%, I'm actually detecting some muon neutrino and tau neutrino? They have no business to be there because what left the sun are electron neutrinos. So if muon neutrinos and tau neutrinos are there, then there must have been an oscillation along the way, like Ponte Carlo had suggested in 1957 itself, long before Davis's experiment. So the Japanese said, let's use this Kamiokande detector to directly test neutrino oscillations. Forget the sun for a moment. Let us try to detect neutrino oscillation directly. And how do you do that? By detecting neutrinos from the atmosphere. First, a summary. First, there were a deficit in all experiments, the chlorine experiment, the water experiment, the gallium experiment, over the entire range of energies. Low energy as well as high energy neutrinos are missing, although not in the same proportion. Is it simply that our prediction of the expected flux of neutrinos is wrong? Or could the standard model of the sun itself be wrong? As I said, all along there was a nagging doubt that the standard model of the sun could be wrong. If so, the predicted number of neutrinos could be wrong. The standard model of the sun, please remember, is an integration of the equation of hydrostatic equilibrium, which tells you how the density changed with the radius and how the temperature changed with the radius. Now, at this stage, solar astronomers said, look, I'll tell you how right or wrong you are. And they said, we will use the technique of helioseismology. In 1997, the results of the helioseismology experiments confirmed that the theoretical predictions of the sound speed inside the sun is accurate to less than 0.01%. You will remember Newton's formula for the speed of sound. It's a function of density and temperature. So helioseismology said, we can tell you what is the speed of sound at the center to less than 0.01%. What is the helioseismology? The sun is oscillating. The sun is oscillating in millions of modes. So the name of the game is to Fourier analyze these millions of modes into spherical harmonics, like we do seismology of the Earth. Now, by studying this oscillation, you can infer the conditions that prevail in the interior of the sun. One can infer the density, temperature, sound speeds, etc. Thus, helioseismology turned out to be an excellent tool to verify the theoretical models of the interior of the sun. So, one confidently ruled out the possibility that the standard model of the sun was wrong. So, if the standard model of the sun was not wrong, then you have to take these experimental results very seriously, which suggested that something funny is happening. So, go and directly look to see if there are neutrino oscillations. What you do is to look at neutrinos that are produced in our atmosphere, not the solar neutrinos. I already alluded to this when we discussed the interstellar medium, but let us revisit this again. Now, what is the motivation for this experiment? Bruno Pontecarvo had conjectured that neutrinos must change their identity back and forth between various flavors. And strong and independent evidence for this came in 1998 from the super Kamiokande detector, which detected 45% and not 33%. A cosmic ray from a distant galaxy interacts with a heavy nucleus in our atmosphere and produces secondary hadrons, like it does in the interstellar medium where there is gas. And it produces pi mesons, k mesons, etc. And let us concentrate on the pi mesons. We said while discussing gamma rays from the interstellar medium that the pi meson decay to mu mesons and neutrinos, pi plus, pi minus, decay to mu plus and mu minus. There we said it is pi zero, which decays to 2 gamma rays, but let us stick with these charged pi mesons for the moment. Now the mu mesons decay to either an electron or a positron, producing an electron neutrino or electron antineutrino, and a muon neutrino or a muon antineutrino, depending on whether it is mu plus, which is decaying, or mu minus, which is decaying. So these are the atmospheric neutrinos. So the atmospheric neutrinos are the electron and muon neutrinos and their antiparticles produced in Earth's atmosphere. The first detection of these atmospheric neutrinos ever was not far from here, in Kolar gold fields, the experiment of M.G.K. Menon and Srikantan and others in 1967. I remember when I was a student in Chicago, Professor M.G.K. Menon coming to the Fermi Institute and presenting the results of the first atmospheric neutrino detection. Unfortunately, that experiment was closed down because the gold mine was closed down, and therefore the operating cost of this experiment became unaffordable. As long as the gold mine was working, then the lifts and the elevators, everything, the expenses were taken care of by the gold mine owners. So this experiment was closed down and we missed the bus. Now there is a talk of building a neutrino observatory in India, somewhere in South India. But then we missed the bus. We were the very first to detect atmospheric neutrinos way back in 1960s. But now we are talking of the late 1990s, the Japanese experiment. So there is the Earth and there is the Earth's atmosphere. Pardon me for the wrong scale, because I wanted to show it in the picture. The radius of the Earth is, of course, some 6,000 kilometers. The atmosphere is only a few kilometers. But just to exaggerate, so that I can draw arrows, I've exaggerated the size of the atmosphere. So there is Kamiokande detector in Japan. There is Japan. A cosmic ray produces a mu neutrino in the upper atmosphere, directly above Kamiokande, and that comes to the Kamiokande detector. So you use the Kamiokande detector to detect this muon neutrinos. But please remember that the muon neutrinos could also be produced on the other side of the Earth by some other cosmic ray. And that muon neutrino will also reach Kamiokande because the Earth is completely transparent to the neutrinos. But please remember that these neutrinos will have to travel an extra 13,000 kilometers, right? Which is the diameter of the Earth. So let's look at this carefully. There is the Earth. There are two neutrinos coming, one from here and one from here. The number of muon neutrinos detected in Kamiokande as a function of direction will be different depending on whether the neutrinos are coming from here or here, because whereas if the neutrinos are coming from here, they only have to travel 10, 15 kilometers, the neutrinos coming from the other side of the Earth have to travel an additional 13, 15,000 kilometers. So if there is such a thing as a neutrino oscillation, you expect different number of muon neutrinos to arrive here from this direction and that direction. So as a function of direction, you expect an asymmetry. So you understand? So that's the name of the game, to find the asymmetry in the number of muon neutrinos. If the muon neutrinos oscillated in flavor, as Pontecarvo had suggested, then because of the different distances traveled since birth, the number of muon neutrinos will be different. So they did this experiment. And here are the results of this experiment. Now, I don't want you to look at the result, but I merely want you to appreciate that what is plotted on the x-axis is cosine of theta, minus 1 and plus 1, and this diagram tells you what is cosine of theta. Because if theta is 0, that means the neutrinos are coming directly from overhead. If theta is 180 degrees, that means the neutrinos are coming from the opposite side of the Earth. So that is theta, okay? So now, this is a very complicated diagram, so I will tell you what are the results of this experiment using a different diagram, and that is this diagram. What is plotted on the y-axis is the number of muon neutrino events, and what is plotted on the x-axis is the cosine of the angle at which they are coming. Cosine of the angle minus 1 means they are traveling 13,000 kilometers from the other side of the Earth. If the cosine is plus 1, they are only traveling some 20 kilometers of the atmosphere above us. Okay? So let us look at that result very carefully. Look at the red histogram over there. The red histogram is the expected number of muon neutrinos as a function of angle if there were no neutrino oscillations. That's what you would expect as a function of angle. Angle is the angle at which they're coming. What does the data show? The horizontal bar with the dots, those are the data points. That is the error bar. So the number of observed muon neutrinos is distinctly different from the number you would predict in the absence of neutrino oscillations. What is it you would predict if there were neutrino oscillations? That is the green histogram. Therefore, you see, this experiment of the Kamiokande spectacularly confirms neutrino oscillations. It is not just that it deviates from in the absence of oscillation, but it agrees precisely with what the neutrino oscillation theory would predict. Okay? So this was a confirmation that neutrino oscillations, which were first predicted by Pontecorvo in 1957, 11 years before the Raman Davis experiment, is in fact correct. So the atmospheric neutrino experiment proved neutrino oscillation. So let's go back and look at super Kamiokande result now. Yes? I think you should, or from? Solar neutrinos. First of all, you're talking of very different fluxes. Okay. The solar neutrino fluxes will be very different from the fluxes that you expect from cosmic rays. So cosmic ray physicists will tell you how many you would expect. Okay. So you read a little more about this. Your question is a well-posed question. The answer is very clear. I mean, the experimentalist clearly had done this calculation. By the way, this was later on proved further by using nuclear reactors in China, Japan, and in other countries, because nuclear reactors produce a very large number of antineutrinos. In fact, the neutrino itself was discovered first in 1957 in using nuclear reactors, because a nuclear reactor, the flux is enormous. So this experiment was done again by linking neutrinos from reactors in South and Central Asia. And because you knew the distances of these various things, this was confirmed again. So there is no doubt that you are seeing neutrino oscillation. Read a little more about this. I can give you the references if you want. So let us revisit super Kamiokande result. The expected neutrino is that much. Raman Davis detected 1/3, but he could only detect electron neutrinos. The super Kamiokande could detect all flavors, although not with same efficiency. Electron neutrinos could be detected with an efficiency which is 6.5 times higher. And this suggested neutrino oscillations. And recall that once neutrino oscillations were proved by atmospheric neutrino experiments, people said, now we must go after this with a new detector. And that's the next story. So the game was to find the smoking gun, as John Bacall put it. Three different types of experiments were done. And please listen to this carefully. Three different experiments using the same detector. The first experiment, which we will call E1, can detect only the electron neutrinos. In principle, it can only detect electron neutrinos. The other two experiments, E2 and E3, will detect all three flavors of neutrinos. So that should settle this question once and for all. Now, what you expect is E1 should detect only 33% of the expected number of neutrinos, whereas E1 plus E2 plus E3 should detect, or E2 plus E1 should detect 100% of the predicted neutrinos, or E2 should detect 66%. So the experiment was done in Sudbury in Canada, 2 kilometers underground, and this is the experimental setup. Truly impressive. And here's what it looks like. There is an inner acrylic volume, a sphere, which contains 100,000 tons of heavy water, D2O. 11,000 tons of ordinary water, you open the tap. But you can't get 1,000 tons of heavy water by going to a supermarket. Okay? Why heavy water? We'll come to that in a moment. So that's inside this acrylic sphere, transparent sphere. D2O and not H2O. This is surrounded by an 18-meter diameter geodesic sphere over here. And on the geodesic sphere are 9,500 photomultiplier tubes, but these tubes can detect single photons. They're super expensive photomultiplier tubes, they could detect single photons. Now this whole assembly is suspended in a cavern inside the mountain, which is 22 meters wide and 34 meters high, and it is filled with 7,000 tons of ordinary water. So this is just like the super Kamiokande, except the inner one is now filled with D2O, and the outer one is filled with H2O. All right? Good. So there is an actual photograph. This is the photomultiplier tubes in a Buckminster Fuller sphere surrounding the acrylic sphere. And these photomultiplier tubes are supposed to detect the Cherenkov light emitted by the electron as it scatters off a neutrino. Now, let us consider experiment number one. Now, this experiment, following thing happens. It is neutrino absorption inside the nucleus. A neutrino is absorbed by a deuterium nucleus, which is a proton-neutron bound state. The neutron is converted to a proton, and an electron is emitted, and it is that electron that emits the Cherenkov light. Okay. Now, please note that this reaction cannot take place in ordinary water. This cannot take place in ordinary water because in ordinary water, the nucleus consists only of a proton. Now, electron neutrino cannot be absorbed by a proton. Please remember Fermi's equation. A proton goes to a neutron plus positron plus a neutrino. A neutron goes to a proton plus electron plus antineutrino. So a proton can only absorb an electron antineutrinos. And electron antineutrinos don't come from the sun. Only electron neutrinos come from the sun and not its antiparticle. But it can happen in heavy water because the nucleus now has a neutron in it. So there's a new feature of this experiment. But please remember, therefore, this experiment can detect only the electron neutrino. But it can detect electron neutrino over all energies. Now let's go to experiment 2 and 3. This is our old experiment, electron neutrino Kamiokande type. The electron will be scattered in the forward direction. This will emit a Cherenkov cone of light. This will give us a vector pointing to the sun, and any type of neutrino can scatter off this electron, as we saw in the Kamiokande experiment. But why fill it with G2O? So that is experiment number 3. Experiment number 3 is the deuteron is broken up by the electron neutrino coming from the sun. The deuteron is broken up into a neutron and a proton and a neutrino. A neutrino of any flavor can break it up. It doesn't have to be electron neutrino alone. And the neutron released is captured by yet another deuteron nucleus producing a gamma ray. That gamma ray scatters a free electron which produces the Cherenkov light, which is shown in that cartoon over there. Solar neutrino dissociating a deuteron. That neutron is absorbed by yet another deuteron. A gamma ray is emitted which scatters off an electron, and that produces a Cherenkov cone. So if this is true, then you should see a cone corresponding to intersection of a cone with the surface, which will be a ring. There is an actual experimental event. So this is something you and I could have done, except there's no reason why anybody would take that result very seriously. The reason is the background events. Please remember, Cherenkov light is also produced by cosmic rays. I showed you pictures of the telescope in Ooty to detect Cherenkov light from the atmosphere. So those cosmic rays could also produce Cherenkov light in your detector instead of Earth's atmosphere. Secondly, the material, your laboratory, is made with things which all have radioactivity. This bottle is radioactive. It's just that the level of radioactivity is not hazardous to health. But the level of sensitivity you are asking of this experiment is so high that the number of events produced by the radioactive decay of this plastic bottle will far exceed the number of solar neutrino events. Right? The air in the mine has radioactive radon gas. You go to any mine, you find radon gas, which is radioactive. Right? Marie Curie, remember. Therefore, the entire underground laboratory is a clean room. Now, if you go to the space department over here, you will find clean rooms in which the satellites are assembled. And those rooms will be as big as this room. And the level of cleanliness, which is measured in terms of the number of dust particles, is fairly modest. It will be some 10,000 particles or a few thousand particles per meter cube. But here you're talking of the kind of cleanliness that is needed in which the chips that are used in your cell phone are made, which is an unbelievable degree of cleanliness. And you are demanding that degree of cleanliness over a huge hole in the mountain. And then there are these trains that come in, bringing in the physicists. That entire thing has to be a clean room free of radioactivity. So the cost of the experiment is primarily due to this thing. Everything that you use to build this equipment, your acrylic, your steel, your aluminium, everything has to be radioactivity free. Right? So friends, that whenever you go after an experiment like this, whether you take a person seriously or not depends on your assessment of whether that person understands the error of the experiment or not. Whether it is a gravitational wave detector or anything else, it is all a question of understanding your energy budget. Okay? Now let us talk about the results. The neutrino absorption in heavy water, which is possible only for electron neutrino, therefore it can detect only the electron neutrino component of the solar neutrino flux. Approximately one-third of the predicted electron neutrinos were detected. So it is the same one-third that came in Davis's experiment. So this time you had an experiment which was not contaminated by other neutrinos like the Kamiokande experiment. So after Davis's experiment, you had for the first time another experiment which could detect only the electron component, and that agreed with Davis now. Okay? 40 years later, it agreed. So one-third was detected. Now let's look at the results as a whole. The first result showed that the number of electron neutrino events was only one-third of what was expected. Recall the super Kamiokande detected 45%. But the electron scattering mode used by super Kamiokande was sensitive to all flavors. And our suspicion was, couldn't something have happened to them as the neutrinos traveled to the Earth from the Sun? And remember that our ideas were further strengthened by the atmospheric neutrino experiment, which directly measured neutrino oscillation. So during November 1999 and 2001, in the first run, the Sudbury Observatory, Sudbury Neutrino Observatory, recorded 500 million events. 500 million events. Out of that, only 3,000 were solar neutrino events. So that tells you how well they understood the background and the errors in the experiment. Okay? Only 3,000 out of 500 million. So the results I'm going to tell you are the cumulative results over 15 years or so. A detailed analysis gave the following result, which was truly sensational. The Sudbury experiment detected a total of 5 million neutrinos per square centimeter per second. Right? The question is, how do you break it up? 5.09 million neutrinos. Of these, 1.73 million neutrinos were 75 million neutrinos were electron neutrinos detected by experiment E1. That is one third. Okay. Now, where did the rest of the two thirds come from? That means two thirds of the total number are either mu neutrinos or the tau neutrinos. So here is the result of the experiment based on data from 1999 to 2006, and the analyzed results were published in 2013. The total flux, which is the sum of electron neutrinos, muon neutrino, and tau neutrino, is 5.25 plus or minus 1.16 statistical error. Minus 0.13 plus 0.11 systematic error into 10 to the power 6 per square centimeter per second. So that is what they measured. And what is the theoretical prediction? The theoretical prediction is that it should be 5.58 with an error of 1 plus or minus 0.14 into 10 to the power 6. Per square centimeter per second. So here is the analysis of it. The two-thirds, so that's the conclusion, that the flux of the muon neutrino and tau neutrino is 3.26 plus or minus 0.25 times million per square centimeter per second. So this is a spectacular confirmation of the neutrino oscillation theory. The extraordinarily prescient prediction by Bruno Pontecorvo and Gribov, which was based on the original prediction of neutrino oscillation by Pontecorvo of 1957, was correct after all. What this means is the standard model of the sun is correct, and the deficit of solar neutrinos found by Davis in 1968 was in fact real. And so, in 1995 already, so let us see, neutrinos were predicted by Pauli in 1930. They were eventually found in nuclear reactor by Reines and Cowan. They detected only anti-neutrinos because that's what is produced in nuclear reactors. Now, belated recognition, this is amazing. Everyone who discovered an elementary particle got a Nobel Prize those 30, 40 years. But not for the neutrinos. After all, it was the first thing that broke way back in 1930. It's one of those very inexplicable things about how the Nobel Prize works. Finally, when they woke up to it and gave the Nobel Prize, Clyde Cowan was no more. Only Reines was alive. So the Nobel Prize was awarded to Frederick Reines in 1995. And the Nobel Prize, he was an old man by that time, and the Nobel Prize was shared by Koshiba of the Super Kamiokande, who used the Super Kamiokande to detect the neutrino burst from the supernova of 1987. Right? Serendipitous discovery. But there was nothing serendipitous about the experiment, okay? All right. Then in 2015, Kajita, who pioneered the atmospheric neutrino experiment, which proved neutrino oscillations, and Arthur MacDonald in Canada, who was the leader of the Sudbury Neutrino Observatory experiment, were jointly awarded the Nobel Prize for the discovery of the neutrino oscillations, which showed that neutrinos have a mass. Now, let us discuss neutrino oscillations. It'll be easy for us to discuss this because we have already discussed this when we discussed the ammonia measure and the two-level systems. When I start telling you, you will remember those things that we discussed in an earlier lecture. Now, neutrinos are created in three flavors. They're called flavors, electron, muon, and tau. But these flavor states are not the eigenstates of the system. The eigenstates of the system with definite mass or definite energy are different. Okay? Therefore, each flavor state is a linear combination of the more basic eigenstates, which are the mass eigenstates. In other words, nature makes neutrinos of three different masses. And you can form linear combinations of those, and they give you different flavors. We will see what this means through example. This is analogous to considering right circular or left circular polarized light as a linear superposition of two linearly polarized light. See, you can say the fundamental thing in nature are right circular and left circular. You can add them, subtract them, and get linear polarization. Or you can say the basic things are linear polarization. Linear combinations of them will correspond to right circular and left circular polarization. So you quantum mechanics enables you to do it anyway, but the sensible thing would be to regard as more basic the ones which are eigenstates of the system. That means states with definite energy. Now, let us look at this thing a little carefully. By nu alpha, alpha, beta, gamma, I mean the flavor states. So alpha is electron, beta is muon, and gamma is tau, or anywhere you like. And nu ijk are the mass eigenstates. So the statement is alpha, beta, gamma are linear combinations of ijk, or ijk are linear combinations of alpha, beta, and gamma. You're allowed to do both ways. And what connects them is a matrix, which is a unitary matrix. And if there are only two states, like right circular and left circular, or only two flavors of neutrinos, then that matrix is a very familiar matrix to you. It is just a rotation matrix in two dimensions. Cos theta, sine theta, minus sine theta, cos theta. So in general, U is a unitary matrix. I'm sure you've studied all this in quantum mechanics. So the flavor states, alphas, are linear combinations of the mass eigenstates, and the mass eigenstates, nu I, b, I, j, k, are linear combinations of nu, alpha, beta, gamma. As I said, this is just like circularly polarized light being considered as a linear combination of two orthogonal linear polarizations. Now, let's do this experiment. Where is this?
I've got two cream eggs making two pendula.
Come on.
This is about coupled pendulums. This is a bit of string, and from the bit of string, I've dangled two pendulums going through a cream egg with a little button on the bottom to make sure that it doesn't slip off. Now then, if I bang one of these pendulums forwards like this, it will eventually stop again. Look, I bang it like that, and at a later time it's stationary. And at a later time, it is stationary. It's magic. And I remember a magician showing this on a television show where he put a handkerchief in front and say, now it's stationary. And it would be. And then he'd open this one up and say, now this is stationary. And it would be. This is magic. Only it's simple laws of physics at work. We call these coupled oscillators. The reason is this is one oscillator and that's another one. But they're coupled in a funny way through the string at the top. And there are little forces as this goes out of line that pull from one to the other, transferring energy from this one, which is now coming to a rest here, over to that one, and then back again. Have fun for Easter, and remember, use hygienic needles if you're going to eat the eggs afterwards.
Do this, as you say, you can then eat the eggs. All right.
I've got...
So, try this experiment. As a very highbrow theoretical physicist was the first one to point out that neutrino oscillations could be understood in terms of this coupled pendulum, if you're dealing with two flavors, and oscillation is just the transfer of energy from one oscillator to the other oscillator. But here is a more familiar one. The picture on the left tells you what the phase relationship between the vertical linear polarization and the horizontal linear polarization should be in order to produce a vector which will rotate in a clockwise direction of the right circularly polarized light. Or on the right, you see the relative phase between the horizontal and vertical linear polarization, which will produce a left circular polarized light. Now, let's go back to basic things. As I said, the mass eigenstates are normal modes of the system because they have definite energies, And that propagation can be described as a plane wave with solutions of the form that the wave function at a time of a particular mass I at a time t is related to the wave function at an earlier time t equal to zero by the familiar relation e to the power minus I e t minus p x or I omega t minus k x, where k is pi by lambda. Okay? So that is the propagation of the two waves. So there are two mass eigenstates. Both the mass eigenstates as a function of time will evolve sinusoidally like this. And notice that the phase relationship between the two mass states, one and two, remain the same as a function of time. That is, the phase relation between these two remains the same. So, if there are two neutrinos and they have the same mass, then these two mass eigenstates will propagate with the same velocity. And therefore, the phase relationship between them will not change with time. But on the other hand, okay, fine. Now let us go back to propagating flavor state. Here is an electron state which is propagating as a plane wave. And the statement is that this flavor one, which we'll call as the electron state, is a linear combination of mass one and mass two. Okay, fine. So the top sine wave is a linear combination of these two sine waves. Please remember, this is time. And because the phase relationship between these two are not changing with time, the linear combination will not change with time. Therefore, the linear combination, which is an electron flavor state, will remain as an electron flavor state at all times. Nothing will happen to it. But please remember that if the neutrino eigenstates have non-zero masses, and if the masses are different, then they will propagate with different speeds. Therefore, the phase relationship between these two will change with time. Therefore, if I take a linear combination and make it into an electron flavor state or a muon flavor state, then that linear combination will change with time. This is analogous to the phase difference. Okay. So here is an example of what will happen. Let us say that these are the two mass eigenstates, the blue curve and the red curve are the two mass eigenstates. They are propagating like that. Let us agree that according to our convention, when the two mass states are in phase, we call it electron neutrino. When the two mass states are exactly out of phase, we call it muon neutrino. And the two phases are exactly the same, electron neutrino. So you see, if the two mass states propagate with different velocities, then what was 100% electron neutrino will become an admixture of electron and tau neutrino, and at a later time will become 100% tau neutrino or mu neutrino, again an admixture, at a later time 100% electron neutrino. So that is the oscillation of the electron neutrino or any other flavor. Okay? So if the blue and red mass states are traveling with different speeds, therefore the relative phase changes with time, and so the flavor states oscillate between electron neutrino and muon neutrino. And this phenomena is neutrino oscillation. So if u1 and u2 are the mass eigenstates 1 and 2, then this linear combination gives me the flavor state, which is the electron neutrino state, as a function of time, because this is a function of time and u2 is a function of time. Therefore, this is function of time. Therefore, the amplitude that an electron neutrino, as it travels, will remain an electron neutrino is this, which will be cos squared theta times e to the power minus I e 1 t, which is the energy of neutrino 1, and sine squared theta e to the power minus I e 2 t, which is the energy of the second mass neutrino. Exactly like we did in the ammonia-Maser problem. It is the very same equations once again. Therefore, the probability that an electron neutrino will remain as an electron neutrino as it travels is the square of the amplitude, according to quantum mechanics. And the square of the amplitude gives me 1 minus sine squared 2 theta sine squared half E2 minus E1 divided by T. Therefore, if E1 and E2 are different, or if the mass eigenstates are different, then the probability that an electron neutrino will remain as an electron neutrino will oscillate with time. So here are two flavor states, the red flavor state and the blue flavor state. What is plotted on the y-axis is the probability as a function of time, and you see that both of them will oscillate sinusoidally with a very definite wavelength, and they are exactly out of phase. So, as I said, when the relative phase between H and V changes periodically, then right circular will become left circular will become right circular, and so on. So, it's exactly the same thing. So, the neutrinos were produced in the Sun as electron neutrinos. As they traveled to the Earth, their flavor oscillated between electron, mu, and tau neutrinos. So when they arrived at the Earth, there is an admixture of neutrinos of all flavors, mu e, mu tau, nu e, nu mu, and nu tau. So the mystery is solved. Since Davis's experiment could detect only one-third of the neutrinos, the number it detected was only one-third of the number that left the Sun. The Sudbury neutrinos could detect all flavors, therefore it detected everything. Now please remember that neutrino oscillations implies that neutrinos must have non-zero mass. If neutrinos have zero mass, then the phase relation between them will never change with time. They will all propagate with the same velocity. Now the present data implies that the mass of the electron neutrino is not zero, but it's awfully small. It's 100 million times smaller than the mass of the electron. This is the current state of the art number. Okay? Nobody has yet measured the mass of the mu neutrino and the tau neutrino. But there is an indication that the electron neutrino mass is not zero, as we thought from 1930. Now, this is a very serious issue because, as you know, one of the most important events in the history of physics of the 20th century is the unification of the electromagnetic and weak interaction by Abdus Salam, Steven Weinberg, and Glashow. Now, if you read about this discovery, Abdus Salam got onto this because one day, his teacher Rudolf Piles in Birmingham asked him the following question: why does the neutrino have zero mass? That was the original question that led to the electroweak unification, which is the standard model of physics. Now we are saying the neutrino does not have a zero mass. It may be awfully small, but as long as it is non-zero, then there is a need to revise fundamental physics. So we are going the full cycle now. 100 years ago, Eddington, in 2 years from now, it'll be 100 years since Eddington predicted how the stars shine. And the proof of that was to find the neutrinos. And when we found the neutrinos, what we conclude is that fundamental physics itself needs modification. Now, this is not the first time where astronomy has had a major role in the growth of physics. If you remember, the law of gravitation itself was discovered in Newton trying to understand why the moon is accelerating around the Earth and why the Earth is accelerating around the sun. Then came Romer's measurement that the velocity of light is finite, then the discovery of spectroscopy by Fraunhofer, then the discovery of the helium in the atmosphere of the sun, and then the first verification of time dilatation by measuring mu mesons in cosmic rays, and of course the proof of gravitational radiation. These are all examples of how observational results in astronomy have led to fundamental physics being revised. Once again, a major input to physics has come from astronomy, and that is that the resolution of the solar neutrino puzzle tells us that the standard model of physics needs a major revision. What that revision is going to be, we do not know. We do not know what is the physics beyond the standard model. So we have need to revise the standard model on two accounts. One is the very early universe at the Planck era, and then something which seems so mundane as to why the sun shines. Both of these have led to the same conclusion. So what this revision is, we don't know. So I will stop there, and in the next lecture, we will completely change gears and go to quantum stars. Are there any questions? Yes, in the back first. Perhaps you can wait till...
There is still a mismatch between the experimental and the theoretical values of the neutrino flux, right? In the Sudbury results.
I don't think so.
Some 5.28 and 5...
No. But then, you know, you have to look at all this detailed and statistical analysis, that picture that I showed.
Okay.
It tells you, that is the analysis of the... Oh, we have to go a long way back. That is the final result.
Maybe on the previous slide you mentioned...
Yes, but that's the same thing. But I'm saying, therefore, then people went back to do a statistical analysis. See, these various circles are... this is all one sigma result. And then you have to ask at what 3 sigma level, what is it at 5 sigma level? So people have done a very detailed analysis, and they are absolutely convinced that the data is in agreement with the theoretical calculation.
Okay, thank you.
I agree with you. You are referring to this. But this is the proper way to finally analyze it. Yes, you had a question.
How did they experimentally distinguish between the 3 flavors of neutrinos? This experiment?
Like. I thought I explained that. First, electron neutrinos are detected in the electron scattering experiment, where a deuteron absorbs the electron neutrino, and that cannot be done by any other neutrino, because a neutron can absorb an electron neutrino. Proton can only absorb an electron antineutrino. And similarly, the other experiments, you should go back and listen to this again and look at the slide. Yeah. Yes, any other questions? Yes, there's...
Did Bethe know about these percentages, this 85-15? Is it from the standard model of the sun?
No, you calculate the reaction rates of all these things.
So that's done using data from the sun model?
No data was there, starting from quantum mechanics, that's all. That's why it's an unbelievable achievement. Just starting from fundamental, basic rules of quantum mechanics. That's all. Yes, there is a question here.
This is just a clarifying question. So there's 2 mass eigenstates for...
No, that only in the illustration. You know, I could draw pictures in the case of 2.
Okay, so there are 3.
You could also have couple pendulum with 3 pendulums.
Okay.
It's slightly more complicated, but But it's easier to explain with circular polarization if you assume there are only two states. But you should really do a proper calculation with three mass eigenstates. Yeah. Good. Let me repeat once again. I am here in the room at 9:30. So if you come, if you have questions, we can continue with questions next time. Okay, next time we meet in this room. I think after that we have to go to some other room. She has another question.
This is related to the question that was asked like halfway through. Because when we were talking about the Canadian detector, they said they detected like millions of results, but then only 3,000 of them were...
No, initially, till they understood the background.
So see, they were detecting the background.
Yeah, so you see the outer detector... What you do in particle physics, X-ray astronomy, gamma ray astronomy, and so on, is you do coincidence and anti-coincidence measurements also. So in other words, you have the inner volume, or outer volume. So it's a question of if it is a cosmic ray event, it must trigger something in the outer volume. So it's a, you read a little bit about it. In everything, it is like this. In X-ray, gamma-ray detectors, from proportional counters, everything. The way you're sure of it is you also do a coincidence measurement of something, an anti-coincidence measurement of something. So that is how you understand the background and reject it. I gave that as an example to show how well they understood the background. And once they understood the background, then only they started seriously analyzing. I have not gone into the details of these things at any time. So I will not be able to answer very detailed questions about how they did that. I am absolutely convinced that they understand the statistical analysis and the significance of those results.
Yeah, I don't doubt their background analysis. It's like physically, how are you distinguishing between the sources of neutrino?
That's what I'm saying. They will have a criterion for if these two events occurred coincidentally, it will be A. If it was an anti-coincident, it will be B. That is the philosophy that is used in all these detectors. All these. Maybe next time I can try to explain this a little further. Yeah, the real secret is in identifying and rejecting background events. In all these things, it's like that. Same thing in X-ray astronomy. It's not as straightforward as it comes because X-ray telescopes do not have the kind of angular resolution that optical telescopes have. So you don't know where this X-ray, how do you know it came from the Crab Nebula? Again, you have to go by these criteria of coincidence, anti-coincidence detectors. I have never done these things myself, therefore I'm not very competent to go into the details of these things. Well, if there are no further questions, we will meet on Friday here and discuss quantum stars.